Hey everyone, and welcome back. We're diving into the world of Bitcoin today.
Really going beyond just the what it is, though.
Yeah, more like, why are we even talking about this? Why does Bitcoin matter?
And why should you care, even if you don't own a single Bitcoin?
Exactly. So to guide us on this deep dive, we're cracking open the Bitcoin Standard by Saifedean Ammous.
Which is a pretty fascinating read.
It really is. Ammous doesn't waste any time. He jumps right into the entire history of money.
I mean, from like barter systems all the way to gold.
To really set the stage for why Bitcoin is, well, kind of a big deal.
Potentially really big deal.
And to kick things off, we've got a foreword by Nassim Nicholas Taleb, you know, the black swan guy.
Oh, yeah. He doesn't mince words.
Not at all. And he comes out strong, saying Bitcoin is an excellent idea.
Which, coming from him, that's high praise.
It really is. And get this, his reasoning is not because it's some technological marvel.
Oh.
It's because Bitcoin has no owner.
And that's what makes it so radical. It's not controlled by any government, bank, any single entity.
It's like the Wild West out there.
In a way, yeah. But to really understand why that's such a big deal, we need to take a step back.
Okay, I'm game. Back to the basics.
Back to the basics. Like, what is money? What problem has it always solved for us?
All right, money 101. Just promise you'll make it interesting.
Absolutely. So imagine this. You've got all these apples, right? A whole bushel.
Okay, I'm imagining.
But what you really want is a new pair of shoes. How do you trade those apples for something you actually need?
Well, you can't exactly walk into a shoe store and plop down a pile of apples.
Exactly. They want money, something universally accepted. And that, my friend, is the core problem money solves. This coincidence of wants.
Coincidence of wants. So it's like a bridge between what you have and what you want.
Exactly. Now imagine trying to buy a house.
Okay.
Let's say, a bucket full of pennies.
That's a lot of pennies.
A whole lot. And that illustrates another issue, the coincidence of scales problem. Money has to be able to bridge the gap in value.
So it's not just about apples and shoes.
Mm-hmm.
We need a system that works for everything, from a cup of coffee to a skyscraper.
You got it. And that's where the three functions of money come in. First, it's a medium of exchange, that bridge we talked about. But it's also a store of value.
Meaning your money should be worth something tomorrow.
Mm. Right. And finally, it acts as a unit of account, a way to measure and compare values of all those things, from apples to skyscrapers.
So if money is supposed to hold its value, what happens when governments decide to just print more of it?
Ah, you've hit on the easy money trap. And this is a central theme in the Bitcoin Standard.
Oh, how so?
Because throughout history, every time we've used something easy to produce AS money, it eventually loses value and savils get hit the hardest.
Ouch. Yeah. So you're saying printing more money isn't the answer?
Well, Ammous would certainly argue that it's not.
So how does this easy money trap actually play out in the real world? Because Ammous uses some pretty fascinating examples.
He does. Remember those giant stone coins? The rice stones used on the island of Yap?
Wait, the ones that were like 12 feet wide?
Yeah. Those ones.
Talk about a statement piece in your living room.
For centuries, they worked perfectly fine. Nearly impossible to counterfeit, right? But then this shipwrecked sailor, David O'Keefe, shows up.
Oh, no. What did he do?
Well, he figured out how to quarry these stones super easily using modern tools.
No, no. So suddenly these valuable stones weren't so rare anymore.
Exactly. It's like finding out your limited edition sneakers are actually mass produced.
Ugh, the worst. Their whole economy must have been thrown for a loop.
It highlights how new technology can completely disrupt things. And it's not just those ray stones. Ammous also talks about those agri beads used in Africa.
Oh, right. They were valuable for centuries, right?
They were until...
until Europeans flooded the market with them.
Exactly. Which, sadly, fueled the slave trade.
A stark reminder of how money and power are always intertwined.
Always. And believe it or not, even seashells were once used as money. But then overfishing made them way too common.
So their value plummeted. Okay, so we've established that rocks, beads, and seashells, not the most reliable money.
Not exactly.
So is there anything that can actually hold its value over time?
Well, that brings us to gold. Now, gold is interesting because it has what we call a huge E stock-to-flow ratio.
Okay, time out. Stock-to-flow. You explain that like I'm five.
All right. So imagine all the gold ever mined in history. It's a massive pile.
Okay, massive pile of gold. Got it.
That's the stock. Now compare that to the amount of new gold mined each year. That's the flow. And with gold, the flow is tiny compared to that existing stock.
So even if someone found a King Midas cave full of gold,
it wouldn't change the overall supply all that much. That's why gold has been so resilient over time. And it's not just about being shiny, either. Gold is durable, scarce, and almost impossible to fake.
So it sounds like gold is pretty unbeatable as money.
Well, it was really practicality. It was great for big transactions.
Right. But try buying a loaf of bread with a gold coin.
Exactly. Not very practical. So that's where gold-backed paper money came in.
Makes sense. Easier to carry around.
Right. People could have these lighter, more divisible representations of their gold.
Convenient, but kind of risky, right? Like, what's to stop governments from printing more paper money than they actually have gold?
You're seeing the inherent issue, and that's exactly what happened to silver, actually.
Oh, how so?
Back in the day, silver was used for those smaller transactions. But then gold-backed paper money came along, and, well, silver just couldn't compete.
Like an early version of getting disrupted by new technology.
Exactly. Like when digital music replaced CDs. So governments are happily printing all this paper money, supposedly backed by gold. What could go wrong?
Famous last words, right?
Right. Well, World War I happened, and governments needed to fund this massive war effort.
Way more money than their gold reserves could back, I'm guessing.
Exactly. So to pay for the war, they broke the link between their currencies and gold.
They started printing more money, even though there wasn't more gold to back it up.
Unfortunately. And that, my friends, is how we got fiat currency.
Money not based on some scarce resource, but basically government decree. And it's interesting because Ammous points out that this whole system, this new system, was actually helped designed by John Maynard Keynes.
Oh, wow. Really?
Yeah. You know, the economist known for advocating government spending.
Right.
So kind of ironic.
Right. It is. And the problem is that without that fixed supply, you know, like gold stock to flow ratio, fiat currency can just be printed endlessly.
And when you increase the supply of something,
the value drops.
Inflation. It's not just some abstract economic term. It's like your groceries get more expensive, your rent going up.
Exactly. Your money is losing value.
So this brings us back to Bitcoin.
Full circle.
Remember Taleb's point about Bitcoin having no owner?
Yeah. No central authority controlling it.
So how does that play into all of this money history?
Well, Bitcoin, with its fixed supply, there are only ever going to be 21 million Bitcoins.
Right. It's like built into the code or something, right?
Right. So it's designed to resist that easy money trap we talked about. No government can just print more.
It's like digital gold, but without the whole central bank issue.
Precisely. It's governed by this open source protocol, a set of rules that everyone can see.
And that no one can change.
Exactly.
Okay, so this is getting pretty mind-blowing. But let's bring it back down to earth for a sec. What does this actually mean for the average person?
Well, it's about understanding the potential consequences of our monetary choices.
Big picture stuff.
Yeah. Do we want a system that's controlled by just a few, or one that's more open and accessible?
Centralized versus decentralized.
Right. One where your money is constantly being eroded by inflation, or one that's designed to hold its value over the long term?
Those are some pretty big questions.
They are.
But before we get too philosophical, let's talk about what a world running on Bitcoin might actually look like. Like in real life.
Yeah, let's get practical.
Okay, so we've gone from seashells to gold bars.
Quite the journey.
And now, digital coins that, like, only exist as lines of code.
It is mind-bending when you think about it.
It really is.
Yeah.
So if Bitcoin actually becomes this new global money, what changes?
Well, imagine a world where saving money actually makes sense again, you know?
Because right now, with inflation, it's like you're losing money by just holding on to it.
Yeah, it's like watching it slowly evaporate. But Bitcoin, on the other hand, it's designed for scarcity. Its value isn't tied to some central bank.
It's about the users.
It's about the collective faith of the people who use it.
So instead of, like, hoping the government doesn't mess things up,
right?
Bitcoin puts the power back in the hands of the people.
In theory, yeah.
Kind of poetic, actually.
It is a fundamental shift in how we view money and value. Bitcoin proponents would say it encourages a different way of thinking.
Long-term.
Long-term thinking. Investment. Personal responsibility, even. If your money is designed to hold its value, you know.
You might think twice about that impulse purchase.
Exactly.
Invest in your future instead. It's like the slow food movement.
Oh, interesting.
But for money.
I like that. A move away from this instant gratification,
yes,
debt-fueled society we're living in.
Okay, but we do have to remember, this is all still theoretical. Bitcoin is still relatively new.
It's true.
It's got a lot of hurdles to overcome.
For sure. Volatility being a big one.
Yeah, I've seen Bitcoin's price swing more wildly than
It can be a roller coaster.
it really can. And we haven't even touched on regulations, the potential for misuse.
Right, and the environmental impact of mining.
There are a lot of complex issues to consider,
Absolutely.
but that's what makes this whole thing so fascinating.
It really is.
We're not just talking about some techie investment strategy here. We're talking about like a whole new way of thinking about our financial system
The potential paradigm shift.
and what that means for all of us.
It's a big deal.
Whether you're all in on Bitcoin or you think the whole thing's crazy, hopefully this deep dive has given you a lot to think about.
Food for thought.
Because the future of money is being written right now, and understanding these forces at play is so crucial.
No matter what happens,
Ammous makes a really compelling argument in the Bitcoin Standard, you know,
what's his main takeaway?
that to understand where we're going with money, we have to understand its past, all of it, the successes, the
It's
failures.
all connected.
And with that, we'll leave you with this final thought.
Yeah.
If money is just a story we tell ourselves about value, what story do we want to tell about the future?
That's the question, isn't it?
That's it for our deep dive today.
Until next time.
Keep exploring.